Endeavor, and a special good morning to you today, Nick.
Good morning, Shannon, and good morning to all the students at our school in London and to all the students everywhere from 200 miles above the Atlantic. I'd like to encourage you all to follow your dreams. Good morning.
And thanks a lot, Nick.
Song 40 Years On, which is the school song of the Harrow School. The wake up music today was for Harrow alumnus, mission specialist Nick Patrick.
This is Mission Control Houston with a view on the outside of the International Space Station, looking at the new Tranquility node and the cupola, which is currently still attached to the end of Tranquility but will be relocated during the cruise day today. That work will start with the depressurization of the cupola by Endeavour's astronauts Terry Virts and Kay Heyer. And then Heyer and Virts will begin operating Canadarm2, the station's robotic arm you see poised and standing by there. They will use that to latch onto cupola and then eventually relocate it. View inside Tranquility, watching Terry Virts and Kay Heyer work through the procedure to depressurize cupola, which is on the other side of the hatch seen here. This is a view inside the station's Destiny Laboratory. Astronaut Kay Heyer is positioned at the robotics workstation, which she and astronaut Terry Virts use to operate Canadarm2. There's a time to get set up for that operation of the arm to relocate cupola while the depressurization is in work. This is now a live view inside the station's Quest airlock, where the spacewalkers for this mission, Bob Behnken and Nicholas Patrick, are working on configuring tools for the mission's third spacewalk. There are 2 days in between the second and third spacewalk now, so the third excursion is scheduled on flight day 10. We see Behnken and Patrick inside the airlock, getting their tools set up for the mission's third spacewalk. They're doing most of this work today, as the next day's work for them will focus on using the space station robotic arm to relocate the pressurized mating adapter number 3. They are the crew members that will be operating Canadarm2 for that relocation. This is a camera, a video camera that was set up by Station Commander Jeff Williams in a small window in the hatch of the Tranquility node on the port that is facing Earth, that is the port that the cupola will be relocated to today.
For Jeff and CBCS, we have a good camera view.
The depressurization of the cupola has taken a little longer than expected, and there are some residual air left inside that will be vented overboard later in the procedure. But the Environmental Control and Life Support System officer here in the International Space Station Flight Control Room was comfortable and wanted to continue on with the procedure to perform the leak check to ensure that there is a tight seal there between the cupola and Tranquility. So that is the next part of the procedure that Virts will be going through.
Closing and not anything else.
Houston Control Station for Robotics, we're beginning motion on the arm.
Houston copies on the big loop.
This is Mission Control Houston. The station's robotic arm, Canadarm2, is now being maneuvered to latch onto the cupola. This is Mission Control Houston. The space station robotic arm is paused in this procedure to latch onto the cupola module. It is being operated by astronauts Terry Virts and Kay Heyer. Inside the space station, Commander Jeff Williams is completing the final closeout steps in the procedure that depressurized the cupola, preparing it for its relocation.
In Houston, the cupola depress is complete. The valve, of course, is closed and it capped, and the vag is left completely intact, connected up to the PCA for the next operation.
Roger.
The space station's Destiny laboratory module. Astronauts Kay Heyer and Terry Virts are back at the robotics workstation, standing by to maneuver Canadarm2 to move the cupola element from its current location on the end of Tranquility to a port on the Earth-facing side of Tranquility. Next to them is Station Commander Jeff Williams, who's been working at the computers to operate the common berthing mechanism and the latches and bolts that are holding cupola in place. During that procedure, one bolt jammed, and during the initial planned troubleshooting step, another bolt jammed. So one continues to be jammed at this point, but not the same as the original one. The next option that the mission control team has is the next step is to de-rigidize or command the joints in the space station robotic arm to go to limp.
Okay, we'll send the stop command.
For about 30 seconds as the arm is holding the cupola in place now.
And Houston, this time we got bolt 1-3 jammed.
And Houston sees that, Jeff.
I'm sure you guys are talking about possible loads from the internal structure contact.
Jeff, right now we're talking about upping the torques on the bolts, and we'll get back to you after we've had some more time to work through it.
The crew on board the International Space Station will now try the procedure again to deploy the four latches that are holding the cupola in place on Tranquility. Commander Jeff Williams and Mission Specialist Kay Heyer had worked through a malfunction procedure after getting an abort message from trying to deploy the four latches on the common berthing mechanism, basically resetting the software and attempting the deployment again. The reset of the software was successful, and the redeployment attempt will come shortly. This all in part of the procedure to unlatch the cupola from the Tranquility node.
And Houston, good news, we're complete.
Houston concurs.
Station Commander Jeff Williams confirms that the latch is deployed as planned.
We're go for cupola deworth.
Houston copies, and in step or procedure 1.410 SSRMS cupola relocate, step 5 is complete. You can pick up in step 6.
Houston from station for robotics. We have the arm in motion, going in motion.
Houston copies on the big loop.
This is Mission Control Houston. The team in the International Space Station Flight Control Room is monitoring the progress of relocating the cupola using the station's robotic arm, Canadarm2. astronaut Terry Virts and astronaut Kay Heyer are at the robotics workstation to conduct that maneuver. Virts indicated that the seal on the common berthing mechanism for Cupola looks clear, but that an electrical connector has popped out from behind the center and that it is recessed and clear of the mating surface, so the team agreed to continue on to the next position of Cupola at the pre-install position just nearby the attaching port.
Go ahead, Jeff, Space Ground 1.
Yeah, that wire that we're looking at, I clearly remember in the cupola. It's in its nominal location. The when I reinstalled the thermal MLI, the Velcro appeared to be intended to be installed such that that wire is visible, and that's just the way I remember leaving it.
All right, thanks for that info.
Nicholas, we copy. I'll go ahead if you want me to do another survey or just zoom in on the electrical cable.
Let's just focus on the cable, okay?
Amor.
This is Mission Control Houston with a zoomed in video camera view of a connector inside around the thermal insulation on the port of the cupola that will be attached to Tranquility again. Engineers just wanted to take a close-up look with the video to make sure that that won't interfere with latches to connect cupola in place.
Looks good. We'd like you to proceed to pre-install. Once it pre-installed, take a look out the window and make sure that this wire hasn't moved and it's going to be out of the way for the latches.
Four RTLs that are steady. We're going to continue the procedure.
Houston, concur.
At 12:25 a.m. Central Time, the crew has indicated that there are four ready-to-latch indications. That means that cupola has made contact with the port that it will be attached to. The next stage will be to deploy four latches to temporarily place a cupola on Tranquility. And then a series of bolts will be engaged in a two-stage fashion so that in the end there will be 16 bolts securing cupola to its position on Tranquility.
On Space to Ground, the big loop, the SSRMS is limped and we're going for second stage capture.
Getting a good shot now of the cupola there on the left portion of your screen, now in its permanent location on the Nader port of the Tranquility module. Nader means that it faces down toward Earth. You can see it's still covered up. Those covers will come off during the third and final spacewalk of this mission that's going to be conducted by Bob Behnken and Nick Patrick.
Both restraint systems moved.
As you can see, the end of the station's robotic arm has successfully let go of the cupola. And Nick Patrick and Bob Behnken, who are currently working inside the Destiny laboratory at one of the robotics workstations there, will continue to back away this arm and drive it over toward pressurized mating adapter number 3. It is, as we mentioned, currently on top of the Harmony node, which in this view would be toward the bottom. It's over toward where the shuttle is currently located. The shuttle docks with pressurized mating adapter number 2. But PMA-3 has been located over on Harmony temporarily to basically just get it out of the way of all the different robotics work that had to be done during this mission, getting Tranquility installed as well as the cupola moved over. But if you look toward the left part of your screen, you see an empty hatchway there on the end of Tranquility. This is where that PMA-3 will ultimately be installed. That is where the cupola used to be.
prior to today's activities. The station's massive robotic arm being moved from left to right as it turns its attention away from the cupola over toward pressurized mating adapter number 3. You can barely see the tip of PMA-3 on the very bottom right-hand portion of your screen. It is actually on the top of the Harmony node. It's a little bit misleading because this camera angle is turned upside down. But that robotic arm is going to be used to grab onto PMA-3 and to begin the process of removing it and move it over toward Tranquility. The majority of that activity will take place tomorrow during the cruise day.
Endeavour ISS, this is WOR. Do you read me? Copy.
WOR, we have you loud and clear. How us?
Yes, indeed. Who am I speaking with?
You've got Bob Behnken, one of the mission specialists, and Terry Virts, our pilot on Endeavour.
Right. Bob, good morning to the both of you. We don't have a lot of time here, so let me get right to it. This node, Tranquility, that you folks have brought up to the International Space Station, I understand as of yesterday it had some troubles. You were part of the spacewalk on installation. Where does it stand today?
Well, we're marching right along at this point. We had a little bit of trouble with what's called the center disc cover. It's a piece of material that needs to be put in place prior to some relocation activities, and there was some interference with that. But from a spacewalk perspective, that was no impact, and we were able to go outside and hook up the cooling system after having hooked up the electrical power on the previous spacewalk. So Node 3 is up and running. There's fans and cooling and lights even, so it's looking good.
Robert, this is not your first time up, and this is certainly not your first spacewalk. Can you describe, is it hard moving all of those big pieces and being in that what appears to be bulky spacesuit of yours, or is it similar to doing any sort of manual labor job?
Well, we kind of describe some of the work that we do as kind of a little bit of heavy lifting. When we're outside in that suit, it's actually kind of like being inside of a balloon. It's pressurized at about a little over four pounds per square inch, which means every time you close your hand on something, you have to change the shape of that balloon. And doing that for about 6 hours can kind of wear you out. With all the gear and all the tools together, we weigh, if we were on the ground, close to 600 pounds inside of that suit. And so it does take some training and some careful practice in order to make sure that you don't get that 600 pounds moving very quickly. Otherwise, you got to put a lot of force in with those hands that are squeezing inside of those balloons to slow it down. So it is a pretty good workout, and we all spend quite a bit of time in the gym trying to get in shape before we step up here to do spacewalks. On this flight, we'll do 3 spacewalks with just 2 spacewalkers, and so each of us will go out for 3 different occasions and for a total of about 18 hours. And that can be really exhausting if you haven't trained for it appropriately.
We're talking live this morning with Space Shuttle Endeavour. Its pilot is Terry Virts. Terry, I understand this is your first trip into space. So far, so good. What was the reaction? What was it like, and did it meet expectations?
It's been a lot better than expectations. During our launch, it's about 8 minutes with the engines running before we get into space. We go from zero to about 17,500 miles an hour in about 8 minutes. And I had a chance to look outside on the way up, and I was able to see the moon outside on the horizon. And then as the shuttle did a roll maneuver, I caught a quick glimpse of the entire east coast of the United States, and it was just an amazing sight. And then you're under this G-force, 3 Gs. It feels like 3 times your body weight. It's kind of sitting on your chest, and then boom, the engines shut down and you're floating. And then a few minutes later, we were going over the Alps, and I was really amazed. The view of the Earth was different than what I expected, much better.
All right. Now, I understand, or I heard, that on takeoff, some of the insulation might have separated. Is that true? And if so, are you concerned?
We're not concerned at all. We did a lot of inspection on the second flight day that we were in space, and we looked at every nook and cranny of the bottom of the heat shield of the space shuttle, and we have a very large team of engineers on the ground that looked at it. There were a couple of small areas where a tile came loose, and on the top of the wing there was a a piece of material that's sticking up a little bit, but it overall it looks really, really clean, and we don't have any concerns at all up here. We've mainly been just really busy working from all day long getting these two modules that we've been installing. That's been our main focus.
Terry, there are only four more flights of the shuttle program here in the United States, and after that, we really don't have any other way to get back and forth to the space station or even into space except with the help of the Russians and their equipment. You're a fairly new astronaut. From your perspective, how disappointing is that?
Well, it'll be sad to see the shuttle retire, that's for sure. A lot of people have spent a lot of years on it, but it's been 30 years, and every program eventually comes to an end, so hopefully we'll move on to something bigger and better. And you're right, the Americans will not be able to send astronauts into space. We will be using the Russian Soyuz. In fact, I had a chance today several times. There are two Soyuzes docked to the space station right now, so I've been down there and taken a look at them. But you're right that America will not have a way to launch astronauts.
The Soyuz space capsules are almost as old as the space shuttle, are they not?
Actually, the Soyuz space vehicles are quite a bit older, at least the original Soyuz are. They've been around since the Soyuz and Salyut days many years ago, and so the Soyuz has a much longer history than even the shuttle does. But the Soyuz has been upgraded over the last several years. There's been a couple of variants, and they continue to make improvements. And what's different between the Soyuz and the space shuttle is that the space shuttle is reusable. We land it, and then we refurbish it, and then fly it again. But each Soyuz is replaced pretty much in its entirety before it goes out to the launch pad to launch again. And so it's almost like getting a new vehicle every time with the Soyuz.
Endeavour ISS, this is KTVI-TV. How do you hear me?
KTVI-TV, we have you loud and clear on board the International Space Station.
That is fantastic. Good morning from St. Louis to both of you. How's it going so far?
Well, good morning to you guys from us here on the International Space Station. So far, it's going really well. We've got the Node 3 attached to the space station. We've got the cooling and electric hooked up to the outside of it. And today, our pilots relocated the cupola, the nice window that's going to be the window on the Earth from the International Space Station to its new home on the underside of Node 3. So it's going really well.
Well, Bob, you know, we saw your shout out to St. Louis last week. Tell us more about your upbringing here. Obviously, we are so proud to have you on board there.
Well, I actually grew up in St. Anne, which is over by the airport there, Lambert. My father's a construction worker, and my mother had worked at McDonnell Douglas. When I was a child, and so I grew up right there in St. Anne. Went to St. Anne Elementary, which is since closed, and I think they've built a new school there at this time. And I went through the Pattonville School District, and graduated from Pattonville High School.
I am curious, Terry. What does it look like from space? I mean, like, we've had a lot of snow, so can you see the snow from space on Earth?
Oh, yeah, we can absolutely see the snow. The thing that's really stuck out to me is just how snowy Earth is right now. I think we're having a cold winter because it seems like everywhere we go, except for Central Africa and in the desert, you see snow. Especially over Russia and Siberia, Mongolia, there's an entire continent that's nothing but snow. So it does look like it's been pretty cold down there. But the view of Earth is really spectacular. This is my first flight, and it was different than what I thought. There's a lot more color to it, and it's even better than what I thought I'd been. As much as I've heard, as many pictures as I've seen, there's nothing like seeing it in person.
That is amazing. I want to ask Bob another question. We understand you brought some special items along with you from WashU, Bob.
I do have a couple of items from Washington University. I have a pendant that was from the mechanical engineering department that they provided for me that is on board Endeavour. And I also have a certificate from the physics department as well that I'm flying for them. So those are two departments right there in St. Louis that I graduated from before picking up my education out on the West Coast and then going into the Air Force.
Station, this is WREG Memphis. How do you read?
We've got you loud and clear.
All right, thank you very much. I'd like to start with Colonel Wirtz. This trip, a long time coming for you, and it looks like the main part of this mission is going to be taking that Tranquility module out of the shuttle bay and attaching it to the International Space Station. How did that go over the weekend?
That's right. We've had a really great mission. It's the first time that the space shuttle or that anybody has brought up two modules at once. We have what's called Node 3 or Tranquility. It's a large living facility, and then we also have a module called the Cupola that was launched attached to Tranquility. And so several days ago, we took those out of the payload bay while Bob and Nick Patrick went outside and disconnected it. I moved it from the shuttle and attached it to the station. And then just today, we detached the cupola from one end of Tranquility and moved it around and reattached it to the bottom. And we've been busy all day connecting bolts and hoses and that kind of thing, getting these modules ready to go. So we've had a really successful mission so far. Bob's done two spacewalks, and we've got both of our main modules attached to the station, which is really, really good news.
Now, Mission Specialist Behnken is from Missouri, just a bit up the road from us here in Memphis, is back on Endeavour with a couple of spacewalks under his belt already. Has everything gone perfectly according to plan, or have you had to adjust a little bit on this particular mission?
Well, I think that the folks that are on the inside have had quite a bit of adjustment trying to just deal with some minor issues that have come up with interference of a lot of hardware. There's a lot of parts that need to be moved around in order to accomplish moving a module out of the shuttle payload bay and actually getting it attached to the International Space Station. And then certainly once you get that module attached and you start to try to take it apart and move pieces of it around the space station, you can imagine keeping track of all those pieces and making sure they all fit just right takes a lot of effort and a lot of folks working together to make it happen. Certainly during the spacewalks, things have gone really, really closely to our plans. We've been able to get through all of our tasks on the last couple of spacewalks, which was really nice. We're able to get electricity and cooling hooked up to the outside of those new modules, which is also really exciting. It means that the folks who are working on the inside aren't wearing headlamps and doing cave diving in order to get their work accomplished. So we're really happy about that as well.
Maybe you could tell us a little bit more about what the Tranquility module is going to do for the scientists that will be aboard the International Space Station. It really adds a little bit more room to the space station, doesn't it?
Oh, it adds a lot. It's a very large module. It's one of the largest on board, and it's going to be mainly a living area. It has several different life support racks that help to recycle oxygen and water and that kind of thing. There's a large exercise machine on there that helps a lot. When you live in weightlessness for 6 months, it can really take a toll on your bodies, on your bones and your muscles, and being able to do exercise is really critical to being able to live in space. And it also is going to have the cupola attached to it, which is going to have the ability to put a robotic control station so you can look outside and move the robotic arm.
Now, you were mentioning a little
probably
bit about
the most important thing that it will do, probably the most important thing that it'll do for scientists is it will get the bathroom compartment out of the U.S. laboratory and get it over into another module to kind of allow more science to happen in that laboratory and turn it into less of a hygiene facility.
Now, you were mentioning the exercise in outer space. Does this mean that the Colbert machine that we've heard so much about, that exercise machine, is that going into the Tranquility module?
It sure is. That's one of the, I'm staring at it right now. It's just a few feet from me, and that's going to move down there. Every day, the station crew members, they run on the treadmill. They have a cycle-type machine, and then they have this weightlifting machine, something called ARED, and exercise is an important part of their day. They spend a couple hours every day exercising, and the great thing about it, having had humans, Americans, and our international partners on board the space station since 2000 continuously. We're going on 10 years now. We've shown that we can live and work in space for long durations, and guys come back in great shape, and that's due to a large part because of the exercise that we do.
I wish we could spend more time chatting with you, but we are out of time. Pilot Terry Virts and Mission Specialist Robert Behnken, we thank you for joining us this morning on Daybreak. You get an extra day in space, I understand. Enjoy, safe travels, and we'll see you back down on the ground within about a week. I think that's next Sunday that you're coming back now.
Have a good day, Memphis. Thanks for talking with us.
From the shuttle Endeavour over towards the International Space Station. And here entering Node 2 of the International Space Station. And there goes Nick Patrick. This is the commander of the International Space Station, Jeff Williams. coming from node 2 to the lab. Progressed from forward to aft in the lab. We passed the robotic workstation. And enter into node number 1. We can now take a right turn and enter the new node 3. This is a view inside node 3, looking towards the port or left side of the International Space Station. To the end and turn all the way around, looking now towards the starboard, you can see all the way across towards node 1, the equipment lock and the airlock. This is our Nader hatch, and earlier today we were able to just look out that window and see down on a beautiful Earth. If we looked out there now, we'd actually see a cupola because we replaced the cupola there to the Nader or Earth-facing location. Just more views of inside node number 3. And here we see a little bit of the work we were doing inside node 3. That sound you hear is the venting of the cupola before we relocated it. Cupola is just on the other side of that hatch, and Terry opened up some valves to be able to vent the atmosphere that was inside the cupola to the vacuum of space. That allowed us to remove the cupola from the port side and move it around to the bottom or nadir side of node 3. Precaution, we do wear earplugs when we're venting like this because you can hear the kind of high-pitched noise as the air is escaping. Once again, this is showing the nadir or bottom-facing hatch before the cupola was placed there. This is just giving you a glimpse of what our view might look like. This is just one single window, but now that we have the cupola there, we're going to have 7 windows facing down in this direction.
Steve's right here, so I'll let him tell you what he's filming.
Well, this is pretty constricted window environment here, and the camera was almost too big to see through the window. But if you look just in the bottom part, okay, there's Endeavour, the port wing of Endeavour. And if you look just in the bottom middle of the screen, it's the cupola on its way to its new home with Kay and Terry handling the robot arm. Segment stuff that was an Orlan suit, which is their spacesuit, similar to ours, same kind of function, just a little bit different design. This is going up into the MRM. These things sticking out are the docking mechanisms and the Russian hatches. So Steve was filming as he went this way, and he missed his turn. If you've ever done that on the highway. Cupola, it looks like there's two arms out there. It's actually the inspection boom of the shuttle arm out in a viewing position in the background. And there's the cupola itself on its way to the new home on the underside or the earth-facing side of the Node 3. In this position, this is called the intermediate position, so we stopped halfway between the end of Node 3 and the bottom of Node 3. And we let, Kate took some video cameras and did an inspection to make sure that the end of it, the bottom of the cupola, was in good shape so that when we made it and attached it to Node 3, there wouldn't be any leaks or any little pieces of dirt or anything wedged in there, and it was in good shape. This is Kay and I at the robotic workstation in the lab. They're the maestros of robotics themselves. These guys went through an awful lot of training and just an army of folks on the ground put their intelligence together to make this all possible. It's a lot of ways to move something from here to there using a 7-degree of freedom robot arm, and these guys came up with the best possible option, and then Kay and Terry trained for months to move the arm to get the cupola in its new position, and worked out pretty well.
Actually, we all went through an army of training. It was the army of one. Juan Garrigo was our training manager. And there's a great view of the cupola while it was floating out in space. And Kay was doing the inspection with that to make sure it was in good shape. And these are the different video views that we have when we're operating a robotic arm. And Steve did a nice job taking pictures here. And that's what I see when I'm moving the arm. That's what Kay and Bob and Nick, the different arm operators, see. And here Steve is filming it going in for the final attachment phase there.
Well, one great thing about this job is the view from the office window just can't be beat. Okay, in the upper left is Node 3, and the lower right is the cupola itself, a little dome-shaped thing. It's actually not very little, but compared to the rest of the space station, it looks pretty petite. You can see all kinds of space hardware out there, a couple different robot arms, one from the space shuttle, one from the space station. That white blanket-like material on the outside of the cupola, that is a thermal jacket, just to keep the cupola from getting too hot or too cold. But of course, it covers up those beautiful windows, and it is going to have an active cooling system. In other words, there will be water running through pipes on the inside, and that will keep the cupola at the right temperature. There it is, berthed to the underside, or the earth-facing side of Node 3, and that white insulating jacket you see, Bob Behnken and Nick Patrick will remove on our third spacewalk in a couple of days. And after that, Nick will go around and open up, here's a sunset in orbit, and here we are at night, sunrise and sunsets just happen constantly. Anyway, after we get the blanket off, Nick is going to go around and unbolt the window shades, and finally we'll be able to actually open up the windows to the cupola. Depress it, take all the air out of the cupola, and then here we are in the evening after we reattached it to a different hatch, and now we're having to open up the hatch and put air back inside of it. So one of the fun things, like I said before, about working in Node 3 is that you can work in any attitude, any direction you want can be up, and you can have a bunch of people in a small space where in on the ground in a trainer it would be really uncomfortable and hard to get to. You can just float and spin your body and get in the position that you need to get in. That's Steve Robinson and Jeff Williams, the space station commander, working down there. Although it seems like really cramped quarters for a mechanic, this is kind of a dream environment because you can get in any attitude at all and get all upside down and twist it and get your head down underneath the panels and work away very comfortably. You've got light and there's airflow and that never gets sore and you never drop your tools down on your chest and grease doesn't drip on you, and it's a really nice working environment. What's called an MPEV, which is a pressure equalization valve. All the hatches have those on, that it allows you to make the pressure the same on both sides of the hatch. So Steve was demonstrating how it does not fit, and now he's demonstrating how it does fit.
That's TJ, one of our station crewmates that's floating on into Node 3, and he's been helping us tremendously getting through these reconfigurations of Node 3. He knows where all the tools are. He knows how they all work, so he's a great help. And that's Terry there, and he's trying to work on a rack. He's trying to do some rack outfitting so it can be rotated easily and conveniently in its orbit configuration. Rotating racks, essentially, that's the way we get to the back of them. We don't pull them out. We just kind of put a hinge on them and pull one end of them down and then kind of slide them out. That's how we get to them. And the racks are launched with some pretty beefy structure that we don't need once we get on orbit. So part of the rack outfitting is pulling that out and putting in some convenience items so we can work on them. So here's Bob and Nick, not in their usual EVA role, but they're in a robotics role. And here Bob is going to grapple PMA-3, one of our last robotics tasks. Is going to be, we're going to do this tomorrow, actually, is to move PMA-3 from the top of Node 2 and put it on the end of Node 3. So we're going to, if it was a hat, we were going to take it off and put it on our left shoulder. And that will be the final configuration of PMA-3. And that's a view of what Bob and Nick are keeping track of. And that's when this shows why the cupola is going to be so nice. They've got this mosaic of views, and in their heads, they got to stitch together all these views and decide what the arm is doing and if they've got safe clearance, not only with the end part of it, but where the joints are and where they're going. And you can see their heads are on a swivel. They're constantly moving left to right and working together to make sure this is all done safely. And there's Kay doing some rack outfitting as well. Kay's got her Navy hat on. And who do we have? I think Jeff Williams in the background and Terry in the foreground here. So we've been busy bees inside Node 3, doing all kinds of different procedures to get things ready. There's I was taking this upside down, so I hope I got it right. Looks like a pretty decent view of Jeff looking down into the cupola, and he's asking a question of Houston to find out about something. What you hopefully we'll see. There's a view looking down into the cupola of Steve working, and also TJ working, and you can see that center disc cover. There's one of the towel bars coming out for that center disc cover, and you can see the center disc cover is removed. That was the, there it is floating by right there. That was the item that was of concern. We thought we had interference there, and, you know, it was a great story, all the hard work that folks put in on the ground to make sure that we could get it out. And that looks like that's it for today.
Endeavor Houston, good morning. A special good morning to Bob.
Good morning, Houston. Thank you very much for that wake-up music this morning, and a special good morning to my wife, Megan, who I really do look forward to seeing here in just a handful of days now. So can't wait to be back in your arms and see you back in Florida and then back in Houston.
This is Mission Control Houston. As you've heard now, the wake-up song played for the on-orbit crew. That song was entitled Parabola, performed by Tool for Robert Behnken. The crew will now have a couple of hours of personal time for their start of day. They'll have a personal time for breakfast and hygiene before starting with their task, primarily the relocation of the pressurized mating adapter number 3. That'll be relocated at the end of the space station robotic arm from its position on the Harmony module to the now open port on the Tranquility module. Other tasks for the day include the internal outfitting of the cupola. That piece of hardware was relocated overnight during the crew day and now installed in its permanent location on the Earth-facing port of Tranquility. The onboard crew will also continue with some other interior outfitting work and then have the afternoon off. They'll wrap up their day with a procedure review for the third and final spacewalk of this mission. It will be conducted by Robert Behnken and Nicholas Patrick.
This is Mission Control Houston with the view on the outside of the International Space Station and Space Shuttle Endeavour Complex. The morning of activities will focus on the relocation of the pressurized mating adapter number 3 from its temporary location on the zenith or top of the Harmony node to its location on the end of the new Tranquility node. Tranquility is seen here about in the top center view with the cupola now on the Earth-facing port, the top in this view. Inside the new Tranquility node 3, astronaut Suichi Noguchi is doing a checkout procedure for the advanced resistive exercise device, which has been relocated to that node. The biomedical engineers and flight surgeons are monitoring that checkout from Mission Control through video, as the first checkout is an unmanned configuration. Noguchi is maneuvering the device within its vibration isolation system. And then as part of the checkout, two exercise sessions will be conducted by two different crew members on the device later today.
Okay, Houston Station Spacecraft 2, ARED 06 is complete, and all axes go back to zero within 15 seconds.
And Suichi, we're still with you on one. That was a great views for the Y and the X axis, but we're still going to need for you to reposition the camera for Z, and sorry if we weren't clear about that.
Okay, so I want to repeat the Z test.
Houston Station Spacecraft 2, CBCS now is routed, so you can check the view at your convenience.
We have the view, Suichi, and it looks great.
This is looking out the port side of the International Space Station through a small window on the hatch on Tranquility on the end of the node where the pressurized mating adapter number 3 will be relocated today.
Go ahead, Zambo.
Hey, PMA leak check, step 3.9. Pressure was zero at GMT 11.55.00.
That's a good number, Zambo. No need to repeat that.
Okay, great.
Shuttle Commander George Zamka reading down the pressure reading for the pressurized mating adapter number 3 that he completed in preparation for the relocation of that element. A view inside the station's Destiny Laboratory where Commander Jeff Williams and Flight Engineer Suichi Noguchi are working through the procedure to release the bolts that are holding the pressurized mating adapter number 3 to the Harmony node. There are 16 bolts that secure an element into place on the common berthing mechanism, and the procedure goes through releasing half of those bolts first and then the second half subsequently. Actually, the release of an element includes releasing 4 bolts at a time. The capture of an element when it is installed is done in the two-stage fashion. The crew members are in the step of the procedure to remove the first set of 4 bolts. In this view, you also see Endeavour's mission specialist Nicholas Patrick getting set up at the robotics workstation. He will be working with astronaut Bob Behnken to operate Canadarm2 and relocate the pressurized mating adapter number 3 after it has been removed from Harmony. Canadarm2 has a firm grasp on the PMA3 at the moment. This is a view on the outside of the International Space Station. Canadarm2 is working from its operating base on the outside of the Destiny Lab on the right side of the view, and it is extended down below this view and connected to the pressurized mating adapter number 3 while it is currently attached to the zenith side or space facing side of the Harmony node. The PMA-3 will be positioned at the end of Tranquility, which this is a view inside of. The hatch behind astronaut TJ Creamer at the background of the view is where the PMA-3 will be relocated to, and it is being positioned there to provide additional coverage or protection from micrometeoroid debris on that port. Astronauts Terry Burtz and Kay Heyer are working on a procedure to outfit the cupola vestibule, its new location and a permanent location now on the Earth-facing port of Tranquility. Burtz and Heyer are working through that procedure to connect power and data utility cables. The operations support officer here in the International Space Station Flight Control Room can see that the fourth set of bolts have been removed. All 16 bolts then disengaged from holding the pressurized mating adapter number 3 in place, and now the 4 latches are being deployed.
And on the big loop, the latches are deployed. SSRMS has a go for PMA-3 maneuver.
Okay, Jeff, SSRMS operator copies that we are go for the PMA-3 maneuver.
Two sets of crew members working side by side inside the International Space Station on the process to relocate the pressurized mating adapter number 3. Station Commander Jeff Williams and Flight Engineer Suichi Noguchi completed the procedure to release the bolts securing the PMA-3 in place.
The I-fill ground steps are in place. You have a go to do your fill part 1.
And also just deployed the 4 latches inside the common berthing mechanism on Harmony.
Copy and work.
Now, astronauts Bob Behnken and Nicholas Patrick will operate the station's robotic arm, Canadarm2, which already has a grapple or a hold on the PMA-3. They will be working at this robotics workstation inside the Destiny Lab to remove PMA-3 from the Zenith port or space-facing port on Harmony and placing it on the port end of the Tranquility node. In this view on the outside of the space station, you can see the pressurized mating adapter number 3 is being removed from its location on the space-facing or zenith port of the Harmony node. This is Mission Control Houston with the VU back outside the International Space Station with the pressurized mating adapter number 3 being relocated by the station's robotic arm, Canadarm2. The robotic arm is being operated by astronauts Bob Behnken and Nicholas Patrick from inside the station's Destiny Lab. It is being relocated to the port side of the station on the end of the Tranquility node. The port is visible here as the adapter is being maneuvered closer and closer to its installation point. You can see the Earth below as the station and shuttle complex orbit 217 statute miles above the Earth to the east of the Philippines. This is a view from the camera inside the port that PMA-3 will be attached to. It is a camera set up for precise alignment of the element while it is being maneuvered in for installation.
And Houston Station on the Big Loop, we are ready for the CBCS view to monitor to.
Copy, Bob. We will put that in work.
The movement of the Canadarm2 to relocate the pressurized mating adapter number 3 is paused at this point in the procedure as the camera views are reconfigured for the final installation. Station astronauts Jeff Williams and Suichi Noguchi have prepared the Tranquility node's common berthing mechanism for the attachment of the pressurized mating adapter number 3. And shuttle astronauts Nicholas Patrick and Bob Behnken will resume maneuvering Canadarm2 to bring the adapter in for its attachment to Tranquility.
Copy. We're about to pick up in step 13 of 1.510 for robotics.
Houston copies on the Big Loop.
Canadarm2 is now in motion again to move the pressurized mating adapter number 3 into its new location on the Tranquility node.
Houston Station on the big loop for robotics. We're at 8 centimeters. We're showing only RTLs 3 and 4, and we think that a positive pitch is, I'm sorry, we think a negative pitch is what we need. We're missing 1 and 2.
Houston, concur, negative pitch.
Okay, here comes a negative pitch.
The pressurized mating adapter number 3 has made initial contact with the mechanism on Tranquility, but only half of the 4 indications have been received that the element is in place and ready to be latched in place.
Hey Houston, we've got just RTL number 2 missing now, so we'll give you a negative pitch and positive yaw.
Concur on negative pitch, positive yaw.
And Houston, station on the big loop, we're going to give our go to the CBM operator that maneuver to RTL is complete.
Houston, copy.
The pressurized mating adapter number 3 is in place and ready for station crew members Jeff Williams and Suichi Noguchi to pick up with the procedure to secure it in place using 4 latches first and then securing the 16 bolts in place in a 2-stage fashion. This is a view inside the Tranquility node looking down at the hatchway into the cupola, where astronauts Kay Heyer and Terry Burtz had been mating the power and data connections into the cupola. Astronaut Steve Robinson also in view working with them. Astronauts Nicholas Patrick and Bob Behnken are done with their activities for the day until they reconvene with the rest of the crew members to review the procedures for the mission's 3rd spacewalk. That is scheduled to start just after 3 a.m. Central Time. And then Behnken and Patrick will spend their night inside the station's Quest airlock to prepare for their spacewalk Tuesday evening. Astronauts Kay Heyer and Terry Burtz are working inside the new Tranquility node. This is the hatchway leading into the cupola that they're making the connections for power and data for that new observation deck. Future robotic arm operations will be able to be conducted from the cupola once the spare robotics workstation inside the Destiny Lab is relocated into the new element. That is scheduled to occur on Flight Day 11. Outfitting of the new cupola will continue over the next day also while the mission spacewalk is ongoing, including installing an audio terminal unit so that crew members can use the station's communication system while inside the cupola, as well as power ports for equipment. And the spacewalkers will be removing the thermal covers on the outside of the element, and crew members inside will be checking out the shutters on the windows. This is a view on the outside of the International Space Station and Space Shuttle Endeavour as the two vehicles orbit together 217 statute miles above the Earth over the South Pacific Ocean. They are passing through an orbital sunset. This is Mission Control Houston. The Expedition 22 and STS-130 Endeavour crews have joined together inside the Unity node on board the International Space Station for lunch. Unity was the first U.S.-built element of the International Space Station launched, and assembled to the Zarya module, the first element to launch for the space station. Unity was launched by the Space Shuttle Endeavour in December of 1998. It is a little bit shorter than the European-built Node 2 and Node 3, the Harmony and Tranquility nodes. This is now a view on the outside of the complex provided by a video camera on Endeavour, looking at the new Tranquility node. Tranquility is attached to the port side of Unity. On the other side of Unity is the station's Quest airlock. The Unity node also serves as a passageway between the Russian segment of the station and the U.S. operating segment, which includes the Destiny laboratory module and the European and Japanese laboratories.
This is breakfast, but today we filmed some human interest story shots for you.
Pilot Jerry Burt sending down some video the crew sent has recorded over the course of their day in space.
You should be getting audio with this. This is Mexican scrambled eggs here.
And Terry, we're getting good nice video and audio.
I'll try not to talk over it too much.
Something to do. They're good.
Good morning. About to shave his face. Everything tends to float away.
His neck shaving.
Проверку нам нужно, естественно, для двух блоков, как ты делал первый раз.
Первый раз файл было два файла. Окончание
ма, другой с окончанием Б. Естественно, ты сделал первый раз правильно, и так и надо в дальнейшем
popular choice for breakfast this morning. So Jeff comes over quite often for meals, for breakfast for us. The technique of eating your food through the bag, that way it doesn't make as much of a mess. And here are Nick and Bob doing the robotic ops today. They got to move a module called PMA-3, which is a connecting module, and they moved it from a temporary storage location back to the left end or the port end of Node 3. And that is now where Cupola was when we launched. So it's been a little bit of a shell game moving modules around to make sure they all fit. Nick was the main operator and Bob was helping him out.
diaper service?
That was a nice view of the cupola. How about we have the whole... we had all the covering and everything open, so we really had our first views of the cupola today, which is really nice. And that right there is the port in an O3, which is now where PMA3 is at. So what you hear there is the sound of that thing repressurizing. We were letting air from the station go into that module, and that humming and hissing and stuff was air going in there. So you can see Kay down there doing work in the cupola. I'm getting some tools. Kay and I were both getting the cupola wired up today. And so there's just a lot of things going on. There was a lot of ARED activity, which is that exercise machine right above the cupola. So it's been a very busy place. You'll notice the Air Force Academy banner there on the side.
Flight day highlights. Getting ready for our crew lunch.
And this was really nice. Jeff put together a crew lunch for us, so the whole crew is down there in Node 1 having lunch together.
There's Bob.
So everybody has utensils?
I do.
They're on TJ?
All right. Hello.
Here you go, Jeff. One more.
All right.
And there's one more in there.
Okay. Well, I'll hydrate these. Huh?
She was part of the opening ceremonies.
Yeah,
the
right. Yeah, I was with Suji.
They have some sushi food, you know. Just, I want to cut this and wrap it with the soy wrapper and make it kind of space.
Like a roll.
Yeah, it's already salmon.
This is great.
It's not raw. It's already
cooked. Yeah,
what is that sushi?
It's a space sushi.
Space sushi.
With salmon.
Space cooked sushi.
Made one.
Then we got Casey Kasem in space. Number 5.
It was good because we had Russian food and Japanese foods. Suichi just had space sushi for us, and that was a really good lunch, and then we got down some American food too.
And that's yeah, you can share.
Oh, yeah. Ramen. Yeah. Ah. Okay. Goji. Hojin Hiroshio. Myasa. Sabashi.
Oh, no, this is the marmalade.
The marmalade. I wish you could wish it was marmalade.
Yeah.
That's when you have to rescue the marmalade.
I wrote the second
that's
one.
That's the version with you.
Sugar and electrolytes in it.
Marmalade.
It's the antidote.
No, you know the story behind marmalade?
Marmalade is, what
you
is that, a drink?
You got the toxic shot.
Oh, no, hey, try it.
Drink it first.
No. It's fruit preserved.
What is it?
That's okay. It's good.
Oh, that is marmalade.
My mother made it. No, it's homemade.
Oh,
mother made
it. Okay.
Homemade? It's the same thing, yeah. My mother made it.
Really?
Really? We can't get
homemade
stuff sent up here.
Jack, I tried to get homemade stuff.
This is a real highlight today, getting a chance to spend some time with our crewmates. Kay has her Mardi Gras banner up there. And she had some moon pies, which are not the best food to have in space.
All right, Suichi Noguchi-san, Japanese ski team.
Here's some Olympics we did tonight. Here's Suichi with his Japanese ski team skis on.
All the way.
Nice job, Suichi.
There's more slalom skis. Here he's doing the slalom.
Slalom and downhill on the same one. Putting down.
Right. Right. Doing the luge.
3, 2, 1, start. Yay! Speed of 100 miles per hour all the way. All right, good job.
All right.
She goes in.
Okay, demonstrating figure skating triple Lindy's here.
Okay.
Okay, real stable at that.
Okay, ready?
Here.
Spin. Oh,
very
that's
good.
Nice.
Oh,
very man. Nice, very nice.
Very good.
Very nice.
Physics professors around the world will love that for angular momentum lessons.
2, 1, cut.
All right, Switchy, nice job.
Go. Spinning.
Come down.
Okay, there you go. Whoa. What are you doing? Okay, watch over here. Yeah. 3, 2, 1, starting.
Very nice.
We still do it, yeah.
Okay, we're gonna stop now.
Yeah.
Feeling?
Yeah.
And we reverted to somewhere else here for diving.
Very nice, very nice, very nice. Okay, spread your arms now. We can slow down. Yay!
Yeah, it's going to
hit that blue thing on this rotation. There you go.
And here is our crew getting ready for the spacewalk tomorrow. Every day before spacewalk, we have a briefing where they talk about how they're going to go out the door, how they're going to conduct the spacewalk and do their different tasks. And that was it.
Good morning to you today, Kay.
Good morning, Houston, and thanks for that music. That song is very appropriate today, performed by fellow Mobile, Alabama native Jimmy Buffett. And on a day that we'll be working on opening our new window on the world, performing EVA number 3 here on the International Space Station and the Space Shuttle Endeavour.
And we certainly agree with you, Kay. We're all looking forward to that.
Today's wake-up music for the astronauts on board Shuttle Endeavour, song Window on the World by Jimmy Buffett, played for mission specialist Kay Heyer. As the crew members move into preparations for the third of three planned spacewalks on shuttle mission STS-130, planning to finish up the connections of the new Tranquility module and the Cupola module, and as Heyer noted, open up the windows on the station's new observation deck for the first time.
This is inside the station's Quest airlock, where the spacewalkers are getting prepared for the mission's third and final spacewalk. Astronauts Bob Behnken and Nicholas Patrick are conducting this spacewalk, as they have the first two. Shuttle Commander George Zamka is also in view here inside the Quest airlock, along with Station Flight Engineer T.J. Creamer, to assist the crew members in preparation for the spacewalk. Creamer and Zamka will assist the crew members with getting into their spacesuits. The crew members have now worn the oxygen masks for long enough in this pre-breathe procedure. So astronauts Bob Behnken and Nicholas Patrick are removing those inside the station's Quest airlock, which is at a reduced pressure of 10.2 pounds per square inch compared to the 14.7 psi of the rest of the station. Behnken and Patrick will continue the external outfitting of the new elements delivered to the station by Endeavour's crew, the Node 3 Cupola, the Node 3 Tranquility, and its cupola, including additional fluid and cable routing on the outside of Tranquility to lead to the new location of the pressurized mating adapter number 3 that was positioned onto Tranquility, and removing the thermal covers on the cupola. Spacewalkers Nicholas Patrick and Bob Behnken are in their suits. We can see Patrick here being maneuvered by Shuttle Commander George Zamka, and Station Flight Engineer TJ Kramer will help with putting on the SAFER, the Simplified Aid for EVA, or Extravehicular Activity Rescue. Spacewalker Bob Behnken is in his suit and just out of view below where this camera is set up in the airlock.
And George, the EV hatch is open and latched.
Okay, copy. EV hatch open and stowed. I'm going to take the emergency MPEV to close.
Bob, I heard you say...
Astronaut Nicholas Patrick now ready to come out the hatch of the Quest airlock.
That's affirmative, Steve. I'm closed and locked onto the forward UIA D-ring.
This is a view from the helmet camera on astronaut Nicholas Patrick's spacesuit. The number 18 in the lower right corner will identify that view throughout the spacewalk as the camera on his suit. And this is a view from astronaut Bob Behnken's camera on his helmet as he is getting ready to come out the airlock after passing some bags of equipment out to astronaut Nicholas Patrick to pre-position on the outside of the airlock.
Thermal cover is closed.
Bob, you are headed by the forward route to the headrail 600.
Copy that, Steve.
Yeah, go, go Nader. When you hit node 3, go Zenith up to the Nick Patrick Highway there, and it's a short one. And that's where you'll throw the OIH bag.
Roger.
Nick, you're heading out to the end of the port end of PMA 3.
And Steve, I copy that.
You'll take the aft route for a change, and you'll stop by at the Node 3 starboard end cone, and I've got a handrail for you when you get out there.
Here I go by the aft route, Steve.
Astronauts Nicholas Patrick and Bob Behnken are moving on to their work sites for the beginning of the spacewalk, having set up the initial tool configurations outside of the Quest airlock. Behnken is moving to the area to open the quick disconnects on the umbilicals that are connecting the redundant loops of the ammonia thermal control system to allow the ammonia to flow through those loops. The primary system was activated during the mission's second spacewalk. And Patrick is moving also around Tranquility to make cable connections for the pressurized mating adapter number 3 that is now attached to Tranquility.
Okay, Steve, booties 3 and 4 are installed.
Excellent. With that, you can close the hood.
Astronaut Bob Behnken has completed opening the quick disconnects on the lab side, the Destiny lab side of these ammonia lines for Tranquility, and he will move to the other side of the lines on Tranquility to open those as well to activate this redundant system for the external thermal control system for Tranquility. This video is from the helmet camera on astronaut Bob Behnken's spacesuit. And while in the area, he is securing some of the thermal covers around the ammonia lines. Astronaut Nicholas Patrick is working on cabling for the pressurized mating adapter number 3. We see his helmet cam view here. He is disconnecting some brackets and releasing cables from the adapter so they can be plugged into Tranquility.
Please, for confirmation, please. I'm leaving F1 bolted in.
affirmative. That's the right thing to do.
Great. F2, 3, 4, 5, and 6.
Heads up.
Eight and 11,
now
seven.
It's those four cable connectors at the dummy panel, and they all have booties.
Roger that.
And remember, when you put the dust caps on those two, 603 and 608, they'll need the booties back on.
Thank you.
Copy that.
And all TA clamps are released and reclosed and headed up to the dummy panel.
Thank you, Dick.
Astronaut Bob Behnken has completed securing those thermal covers in place for the ammonia lines and is going over to the other end of the lines to open the quick disconnects on the Tranquility side.
I don't know if you can look at camera 9, Steve, at all and see anything on kind of the status of how pushed down the MLI there is.
We'll work on that.
Steve, I'm headed up with the cable bunch.
That's great, Dick. You got that 603 off, okay?
Yeah, the 602 and 603, the connectors were very hard to demate, but they're done.
Very good. And the dust cap is on 603 plus booty?
I will, the booties are on. I'll do the dust caps up here at Zenith.
Oh, that's right. Thanks.
These spacewalkers have completed their tasks with the setup of the systems for Tranquility. Later, they will install some handrails and worksite interfaces for future spacewalkers on the outside of the element. These spacewalkers have joined each other near the cupola to begin removing the insulation from the outside of that element. The cupola is 3 meters in diameter, or about 9.8 feet, and 1.5 meters high, or about 4.7 feet. Once the insulation is removed and bolts securing the window shutters in place are taken out, the crew inside cupola can check out the window shutters. Once the crew members remove the insulation covers, Patrick will be the one to release the 3 bolts on each of the window shutters for the 7 windows, while Behnken moves on to install some equipment on the outside of Tranquility to help future spacewalkers, such as handrails and worksite interface connectors.
You can get to work on your side of the ground faster. Expect 12 turns each.
Right to that. Am I at those PGT settings the second time, Matthew?
You bet. Alpha 5, counter 2.
Alpha 5, counter 2. Thank you. Okay, Steve, the bag is secure on the top of the cupola. I'm going to do on a glove inspection first before I get it tethered.
Okay.
Get the MLI tethered. Okay, cover 1, bolt 1 is released. Sorry, cover 1, bolt 2, released.
Okay, cover 1, bolt 2. Got it. Thanks, Bob.
Cover 4, bolt 1 released.
Nick, you cut out a little bit. I copied cover 4.
Cover 4, bolt 1 released.
Copy. Cover 4, bolt 1. Excellent. Got some really neat views of you both working around the cupola.
Well, thank you.
These spacewalkers are now working on removing the insulation covers.
Panels are rested inside the bag. They are ready inside the bag. Thank you.
These spacewalkers will work together to roll up and fold up each of the covers into two separate assemblies that will be bagged up into a bag that the crew members brought out of the hatch of the Quest airlock with them. This is a view from the helmet camera on astronaut Bob Behnken's spacesuit as he's working to roll up one of the panels for the insulation covers on the outside of the cupola. The crew members have completed removing the insulation covers from the outside of the cupola. This view on the outside of the station of the spacewalkers as the vehicle passes over the Earth into an orbital sunrise over London.
That's about 10 tons of MLI in an ACOM bag. Terrific job pulling that up. You guys made that look easy.
I don't know about easy. It wasn't, but thank you.
Now we've got about to have cupola have its first orbital sunrise, and its gleaming metal looks terrific.
Spacewalkers Bob Behnken on the left and Nicholas Patrick on the right working on the outside of the new Tranquility node and cupola. Patrick is removing bolts that held the shutters on the cupola's windows in place, and Behnken is working on installing worksite interfaces and handrails for future spacewalkers to use. This is a view from the helmet camera on astronaut Nicholas Patrick's spacesuit, watching him remove the final bolt holding the window shutters in place.
Steve, window 6, bolt 2 is released. That's all of them.
Window 6, bolt 2, that checks off my matrix of launch lock bolts also.
These bolts did not work exactly as they did in the MBL. I'm just going to do a quick, they didn't pop completely free until you get the third one. So I'm just going to do a quick survey around the cupola here and make sure that I really drove all of them the required number of turns.
Okay, that sounds good, and looks like you're doing a great job keeping your safety tether in your field of regard.
Thank you.
And Houston likes that plan.
Steve, I'm now 10 feet from all windows.
Copy that. If you need to come closer than that, do let me know, but I think for your further movements, you do not need to. Do you concur?
I concur, yes.
Okay, and Bob, the windows number 2 and 3, the station forward windows, are the ones closest to your side. We'll make sure we keep those closed.
Okay.
The crew members on board the International Space Station and Space Shuttle Endeavour have coordinated the spacewalkers' locations and opening the first shutter on the cupola, window number 7, the circular window on the top.
I see it opening. As expected, the view through window 7 is absolutely spectacular. This has to be the largest window on board, and when we have the others around it open, it will give us a view of the entire globe. Absolutely incredible.
Window shutter number 7 being closed by the turn of a knob from inside cupola. We can see the two crew members working together, astronaut Bob Behnken in the suit with the red stripes around the legs and astronaut Nicholas Patrick with him Their task together is to route some cabling on the outside of the station for the video signal converter that helps with the video cameras on the space station's robotic arm. The crew inside the International Space Station shutting the cover on window number 3 in the cupola now. Only one shutter remaining to be tested, number 2. And there, shutter number 2, the last window covering to be tested on the cupola is opening. The crew members inside cupola open the shutters by the turn of a knob. Crew members visible in the window looking out of the cupola. The side of the cupola with the window open faces forward on the International Space Station.
Mission Specialist Bob Mankin making his way back inside the Quest airlock. The addition of the Tranquility node and the cupola addition to Tranquility mark the 98% complete point for the International Space Station. And with the work done to during today's spacewalk, setting up the final ammonia cooling line for Tranquility and the heater cables for the pressurized mating adapter, that marks actually the completion of the external thermal control system for the International Space Station. The crew getting some video. Pilot Terry Virts there, the cameraman. Virts has been working to install panels to cover up the wires and cables that the crew has been connecting and outfitting today.
It's amazing.
You can see the thickness of the atmosphere. You can see the clouds coming and going, the continents coming and going.
Nick, we're getting ready to go out the hatch here for the third spacewalk and the final spacewalk. Today was a little different. Nick was the first one out the hatch. Here are Bob and I being put into the station airlock in preparation for EVA. I'm already in head first, and there's Bob waving. He's going to be put in second. I'm going to open the hatch today, and Bob's going to operate the control panel for the airlock. Two suit-up experts were T.J. Creamer, seen here, and our commander, George Zamka, and they got us out the door in, I think, record time for this mission, and in really great shape to do our last EVA. Here you can see T.J. and George just off the left of the screen putting the SAFER, that's the Simplified Aid Preview EVA Rescue, on Bob's backpack, his plus. And this is the little rocket pack that, if you ever to drift free of station and your safety tether would be broken, would fly you back to so you grab onto the station and come home. Because if you were to drift away, there'd be nothing to come get you. Station can't move around the sky the way shuttle can. There's George on the left. On goes SAFER, and the next thing will be Bob going feet first into the airlock. Really, in terms of EVA preparation, one of the easier times for the EV crew member, because you don't have to do anything. You just hang on to a handrail and somebody else. us does all the hard work, as you can see. And Terry's reminding me that ends really soon. Once you're out of the airlock hatch, it's all hard work. And in goes Bob. And you can see Bob's still on an umbilical so that we don't deplete our oxygen tanks while we're waiting to go out the airlock. We wear an umbilical till the last moment to bring us oxygen straight from station. TJ on the right there is an Army helicopter pilot, very experienced helicopter pilot. And George, back in the distance in the blue shirt, is a Navy fighter pilot. I'm sorry, a Marine fighter pilot. So. George is a Marine fighter pilot, so we have in very, very experienced hands as we get put in the airlock. Here's TJ closing the inside hatch, and this is not too long before we'll depress the airlock and open the outside hatch to begin the EVA. On the right in the red shirt is a Russian cosmonaut here on the International Space Station.
This does give us a lot more access without that red bar.
So here we are back in the cupola. Kay and I were there most of the day. Doing various connections and fittings, and basically it's called module outfitting, getting the cupola ready for its permanent life here on the space station. This particular task was hooking up some water lines, and there's really, really tight connections and a very high torque that you have to do, so there are special tools that we have. They're pretty tough to get fit on there, so we spent a couple hours getting these different connections hooked up. And the person in the green shirt there is an Air Force pilot, just to be clear. And here is the view from the cupola, pre-window opening. And during the spacewalk, Bob and Nick, one of their tasks was to go out and remove some launch bolts that held the windows in place. So until they did that, we could not open up the windows. And here's a view of Stevie Ray Robinson. A civilian pilot, and he was busy. He spent most of his day in the cupola and those three turning wrenches and doing various tasks that we had. Along with us was Jeff Williams, and he was really kind of the bedrock for everything that we did. He's an expert on the station. He's very efficient. He's been really helping us get everything done. Kay is putting together one of our boxes. It's called an ATU. It's the communications box. And that those two hoses were water lines that are used to cool it. So that was one of our tasks today. Here's a view from the docking compartment. You can see the several robotic arms, the shuttle arm and the station arm. And there on the cupola, you can see Nick Patrick doing his work. This is just a wonderful view that they have from the Russian module. It's called the docking compartment. And you can see him doing work there. And Nick's loading up to take a look at this. He hasn't seen this yet. Locks were a lot of fun. There were 21 bolts. Some of them were stiffer than expected, but I think it took the best part of an hour to unback them all out. And as soon as I did, the window shutters were visibly loosened. The windows were opened a few minutes later. Okay, and this was the funnest part of the day. One of our tasks was to do a window check. And you can see Kay and I in there, and that's window 7. That's the window that looks straight down. So you can see we opened it up and we just closed it. And it was a real honor to get to be one of the first people in there to open up the window. We had to coordinate with Bob and Nick to be sure that they were complete with their tasks and that they were not in the way. And so there was a little bit of coordination between us and the shuttle, which is where Stevie Ray and Zimbo were conducting the spacewalk, and the ground, where they were tracking things also. So that was fun. It was a good example of how we coordinate between station shuttle and the station control room on the ground in Houston, and also the shuttle control room on the ground in Houston. There's a lot of people doing a lot of work for this mission, and there Kay just was the first person to open that window, and she's taking a look outside. And here comes Jeff Williams down. He's going to help us out. This camera was, as you can tell, it was pointed Nader, and a lot of us either bumped into it or didn't even know it was there, just because one of the things with a cupola in its orientation is it's just you've got to flip over in order to be heads up in the cupola, which can confuse you for a little bit. So here are views from inside the cupola looking out. And we've got several of these, but just witnessed a spectacular sunset from cupola. And one thing that unlike a flat window or a paned window, when you have a hemispheric window, you don't have to have your face right up there. You can actually back up and just take in the whole view. But you can pretty much see the whole Earth out that window. We've got more coming. This is the conclusion of the EVA, and we'll let this go for a while, but this is Bob Behnken coming on in, and you can tell that there is a massive bag. That front bag, I believe, was the MRI from the cupola that was coming in. And Bob, of course, comes in head first, and Nick was outside, and Nick was handing him more bags. So this is kind of like packing for a vacation, you know, in a Volkswagen Beetle. You know, it's just very limited volume to put your stuff in. And, of course, the spacewalk, we still have one spacewalker to go, and he is going to come in feet first. And so this was, I was filming this, and so it took a little while to get Nick up there, but you'll see his feet coming up there shortly, and then the two are there. Well, no, it's another bag. The two are in their kind of reverse attitude, and Nick's job today was to close the hatch.
Closing the hatch is crucial. Without that, you can't repressurize the airlock and then come in. In fact, without that, they won't let you in because there'll be a hole in the airlock, a really big hole. The hatch is hard because it swings into the airlock before you can lower it into what effectively is the airlock floor. And I think there you can just see me coming in, feet first, through that hatch opening. And right before you close the hatch, you have to close the thermal cover. It's like a piece of MLI that keeps the temperature of the hatch itself under control. All these things are actually quite difficult, and this was the first spacewalk in which I operated the hatch on spacewalks 1 and 2 that have been done by our EV1, Bob Behnken, whom you see right there through the hatch window this time. This was the end of the EVA, and I think we were fairly tired, end of the third EVA. Feeling, Mike, if when you're catcomming here and there's folks up here, if you can't find them, I would look in the cupola because there's going to be a lot of folks enjoying time in there.
That makes sense. We wish we were there too.
that view right there, I had a chance to see Bob and Nick go in right at the end of their EVA when they were clear. We opened up the window and had a chance to see them do their last ingress into the airlock. The airlock's just on the other side of those tanks sticking up.
And we're getting good video down here. Looks great.
Excellent. Okay, I don't think this bears too much narration other than it's really neat to stick your head out and look at the station. You can see the Progress, the Soyuz. You can see it right in the payload bay of Endeavour. You can see both robotic arms, the truss. You really get a sense that there's a whole big station around you, which is really neat. You can also look into the window of the docking compartment. Now, we tried to get some video of somebody waving in there, but the sun just provided too much of a reflection. Here, Terry's getting a good shot of the moon. Looking out through the cupola, that struck me right away is that you don't get a view like that anywhere else other than EVA. And in some ways, it can be even better, less restricting than being inside that helmet. For instance, in the EMU, you can't really look up at all, and you're quite restricted left and right also. And here's a 360 degrees around and up, and all squashed in with the rest of your crew. So there's some elements that are like the EVA and some that are maybe even better.
Steve, that sounds awesome. Unfortunately, we lost the signal for those last little bit of it. If you can hit pause and rewind a little bit.
Mike, that was the end of our flight day highlights, and here is a...
Okay.
Zemo gave me a tape, and I just did a 360-degree tour, so I think narration will just detract from creation there. I'll let you guys watch.
Okay, we're getting a good downlink again. Thanks.
There's a striking resemblance to the STS-130 patch there.
Just missing your little faces in there would be perfect.
They're not so little or perfect, but I'll predict that hopefully you might see a picture like that before we land.
Sounds good.
Was in there, that's the docking compartment, but it was hard to see because the sunlight was reflecting. So then I flipped it around and tried to give this is the attitude that we would have, thinking that the Earth was down below us. So I just flipped the camera over to give you a different perspective. It really is a different perspective. Everywhere in station, it's easy to rotate yourself, give yourself a few seconds, and then you can convince yourself of your new up and down orientation. But in cupola, it's really hard to do that because the Earth is below you, and you always have a sense that that's down. So that's the only place I found it impossible to get a sense of that. Whenever you open your pocket in there, you feel like something's going to fall out of it. But of course it doesn't, it just floats there. So that's interesting.
Other crew members moving in there to see the window opening. That's Commander George Zamka, and just motioning in Mission Specialist Kay Heyer as well. Cupola here will eventually be the home of a robotic workstation that will allow the teams controlling the space station robotic arm a real-time view of what's going on outside the station rather than just relying on video views as they currently do.
Special good morning to you, Stevie Ray.
Good morning, Houston. Man, I wish I could play a guitar like that. But it's great to be up here, and wonderful day to transfer some Equus Regen racks into the brand new Node 3. Thanks a lot for the good wake-up.
This morning's wake-up call to the crew of Space Shuttle Endeavour, the song Oh Yeah by Johnny A, played for Mission Specialist Steve Robinson. Crew on orbit, ready to get started on their day, when, as Steve Robinson mentioned, they'll move the rest of the systems racks for the regenerative Equus system over to Tranquility. They'll continue outfitting the cupola module, pack up all of the spacewalking tools that were used, and coming up in less than an hour, get a congratulatory phone call from the President of the United States.
Endeavour, ISS, this is White House Tom. Please stand by for the show.
Hey, guys.
Good morning from the International Space Station and from the Space Shuttle Endeavour, Mr. President.
Well, it's great to talk to you guys. I wanted to, first of all, just say that we've got a bunch of very excited young people here with us, along with a bunch of somewhat excited teachers. We have one engineer and one member of Congress. You've got a whole bunch of press here, so it's a pretty motley crew. And one president.
Two astronauts are from Maryland.
But I just wanted to let you guys know how proud we are of all of you, what you guys have been accomplishing. I've had a chance to take a look at what the Tranquility module is doing. Everybody here back home is excited about this bay on the world that you guys are opening up, and Stephen Colbert at least is excited about his treadmill. And so we just wanted to let you know that the amazing work that's being done on the International Space Station, not only by our American astronauts, but also our colleagues from Japan and Russia, is just a testimony to human ingenuity, a testimony to extraordinary skill and courage that you guys bring to bear, and is also a testimony to why continued space exploration is so important, and is part of the reason why my commitment to NASA is unwavering. But instead of me doing all the talking, I wanted you guys to maybe let us know what this new Tranquility module will help you accomplish. One of the things that we've done with our NASA vision for the future is to extend the life of this, our participation in the space station. And so we just want to get a sense of the kind of research that you guys are doing, and then maybe I'll turn it over to some young people to see if they've got any questions.
You have the joint crew of Endeavour and the space station, and we are the ones that are fortunate enough to be able to accomplish this great mission together in space. But there are many thousands of people around the world that gave the best of themselves over many years in order to have the days that we've been having up here. For your question, I'm going to turn it over to ISS Commander Jeff Williams.
Well, Mr. President, as you know, the ISS has been under assembly for many years, over a decade now. And as George said, it's because of the efforts of thousands of people around the world among the international partnerships. And we're the arrival of this module means several things. It means, of course, that everybody's aware of this new grand view that we have of the world below us. And that brings a special significance. But the Tranquility module also is going to serve as a gym, as a hygiene area, as a place that a crew can maintain themselves for a long duration. And long duration, living and working in space is what the space station is all about. To do the research and the science necessary to take us beyond Earth orbit. That was the ultimate purpose of the space station. And the arrival of this module will enable us to do that. And it really marks the end of the major assembly of at least the U.S. orbiting segment as we transition into full utilization of this magnificent orbiting laboratory.
Do you guys want to just mention some of the research and experiments that you can conduct on the space station that you could not be doing back here at home?
That's a great question, Mr. President. Let me start off by saying one of the nice things about where we physically are right now is that we remove the effects of gravity. So we're able to do experiments that involve the effect of gravity basically on Earth as we look at what happens with the absence of it. For instance, when you do combustion studies, flames on Earth burn in a teardrop fashion because the air comes in from underneath it and feeds the flame, but we can't do that here since the air doesn't know where up is. There's no convection, so the flames burn very purely in a ball. In a similar sense, when we do cellular research for like for cancer research, for instance, on Earth, the cells actually collapse under their own weight, and so their growth on Earth are a little bit distorted. Here, without the gravity effect, we can grow cells very purely and understand the mechanisms by which that they are replicating. We're also doing metallic research and materials research to help us understand how to make materials on Earth better, but also to find out what materials are better for long duration missions and traveling beyond Earth's orbit. Some of the other experiments involve biological, where we actually have, for instance, butterflies up here, and we watch the life process of the butterflies. Many, many experiments up and down the stack are quite exciting when we are able to remove the variable of gravity.
Well, some of the things that you talked about are in line with where we want to see NASA going increasingly. What are those transformational technologies that would allow us to potentially see space travel of longer durations if we want to get to Mars, if we want to get beyond that, you know, what kinds of technologies are going to be necessary in order for us to make sure that folks can get there in one piece and get back in one piece, and that the kinds of fuels that we use and the technologies we use are going to facilitate something that is actually feasible. And we're very excited about the possibilities of putting more research dollars into the, some of these transformational technologies. So we're excited by what you're doing and what folks back on Earth as part of NASA's engineering teams and scientific teams are doing. What I want to do is give some of these young people a chance to ask a couple of questions, but I'm not sure I've got any volunteers, so I'm going to turn around.
Oh, you do.
Oh, look, this is a serious bunch here, I can tell. So I'm going to hand the phone over to the first one. Hold on.
What's your name?
Ruth.
This is Ruth, coming from North Carolina.
What are some of the benefits of exploring space as opposed to exploring other places on Earth?
Okay. Pretty serious question, guys. You better have a good answer to the NASA folks who are sitting here listening.
Ruth, I can tell you your curiosity reaches far, and so does ours, and that's sort of the human spirit to find out what can humans really do. And one thing that's always been, I think, amazing to every person who travels in space is that the human body is adaptable to this environment, but adaptable in what way? And how does the human body and even the human brain adapt to this very, very different environment? Learning about how we ourselves work and how we can handle changes if we go somewhere very different than what we're used to is something that's valuable also on Earth, because our environment changes on Earth too. And in terms of health and medicine, we understand better how our own bodies work. So there's a lot to be learned.
All right, who's next?
Mary.
All right, this is Mary coming at you.
What inspired you to become an astronaut?
Got any takers on that one?
Mary, hello, this is Nick Patrick. The thing that inspired me to become an astronaut was watching the Apollo moon landings many, many years ago with my parents. I thought I wanted to be a space explorer then, and I stuck to my dream. I stayed in school, I studied hard, and through schoolwork and also an interest in things like sailing and flying, I was able to realize my dream. So I would have some advice to all of you there, which is study really hard in school, listen to your teachers. They're full of knowledge and experience that you really can use in whatever path your future life takes you along, whether it be engineering, science, a job in business, or even space exploration.
All right, let's get, we got one of our young people from?
Nebraska.
From Nebraska, and what's your name?
Jordan.
This is Jordan from Nebraska.
Do you think it would ever be possible to create artificial gravity in space?
That's a big physics question there, guys. Anybody want to tackle that one?
Hi, Jordan. This is Terry Virts here, and that's a great question, because one of the hard things about long-duration spaceflight is the human body dealing with weightlessness and a lack of gravity. And one way you can create gravity is to spin things. If you take a bucket of water or paint, you can spin it around, and you'll notice that the water stays pressed up against the bucket because you're accelerating it. And so you can artificially create that acceleration that makes you feel like you're in gravity, just by rotating something like a centrifuge. So it is possible, but to do that, it requires a really large structure. And so that's something that we haven't done here on the space station, but that's one way you could do it.
That was a great question. All right, we need a Michigan. We got to make sure every state is represented here. What's your name?
Shanae.
Okay, go ahead and introduce yourself, Shanae.
I was just wondering, what kind of training did you have to go through before you were able to get into space?
That was Shanae.
Well, that's a great question. You know, it takes a lot of experience to be an astronaut, and it's not just in one field. We've all been through many, many years of school, but also experience in our own fields. So we have engineers, scientists, mathematicians, medical doctors, and physicists. We have quite a range of experience that become astronauts. And the important thing is that you have a good solid background in the technical fields, the science, the technology, the engineering, and the math, to build on that. Because once everyone comes and is selected as an astronaut, we all train generically for space flight, and then we train specifically for our mission. For the International Space Station, it's a very complicated and very large spacecraft, so the training is over multiple years just for a specific flight. For the space shuttle, being a shorter duration flight of just a couple of weeks, we still train for over 1 year just specifically on the task that we'll accomplish on our mission. So it's quite a bit of time, but it certainly is worth it. It's quite rewarding to us to be able to execute the mission that we've been training for so long.
And I think we need to have at least one Floridian, is that right? Yes. That, we already had a Floridian. Do we have every state covered so far here? All right, we've got time for a couple more questions. We were going to get a little gender balance here. This young man down here, what's your name?
Joseph.
Joseph. Hold on one second. We've got a question from Joseph from Nebraska.
Are there any recognizable landmarks that you can see from space?
Yeah, the rumor was is that you can see the Great Wall from space, but I'm not sure that's true. So are there, at least if there aren't man-made landmarks, are there some natural landmarks other than continents that you can see?
Yes, Mr. President and Joseph, that's a great question. Actually, one of the great achievements in this mission, we have a great window, big window, that we are really fascinated by the great view of the Earth. And yes, we can see a lot of great landmarks. We can see the Golden Gate Bridge, the great skyscrapers in New York, and the Grand Canyon is just breathtaking. And also, while you're in the night pass, we can see all the lights. That means that the humans are active even in the night, and this is a great benefits that we all benefit from being in space.
Well, there you go. All right, we've got, looks like I've got a couple more questions. Hold on. What's your name?
Barbara.
This is Barbara from?
Florida.
From Florida. Hold on.
Hi, I'm curious about the thoughts and emotions that you guys feel when you're in space.
There you go. Do you start getting lonely? Do you feel a little claustrophobic? Vertigo?
Well, that's an excellent question, and I think that probably it ranges quite a bit over the period of a space shuttle mission, and I expect it probably varies quite a bit over the range of a long duration mission. Kind of starting off for the shuttle mission, at least for me, I've done that twice now. You kind of get into orbit, and you're just kind of finding the equivalent of your sea legs, if you will. And so you've arrived on orbit, and you kind of have a feeling of joy having accomplished it. Your body has just gone through kind of a little bit of a violent experience through the launch, and you have a little bit of adrenaline probably getting out of your system. So it's a little bit of a joyous, giddy moment at the same time that you're disoriented as you deal with the first couple hours of actually being on orbit. After that passes, after a couple of days, for me it was a kind of a sense of wonder as you explore what you can do in zero gravity and the things that you can see out the window and just how the entire complex works together to make it happen. So it's just a sense of wonder. After a little while after that, I think you start to think a little bit about the people who are back on Earth that are most precious to you, and then that the little bit of a loneliness can kick in. And one of the really nice things that we have and the long-duration crews have is the opportunity to use a telephone or to perform a video conference similar to like we're doing with you guys with our families. And I think that's really important for folks to maintain that contact when you're up here on orbit. Of course, you have your crew members, but you do really want to maintain those precious relationships with all your family members and friends that are on the ground. And they do a remarkable job actually supporting us while we're in space to make sure that we can still speak with our families and that our families are informed and able to stay in contact with us. But all those emotions kind of wrap up together. Kind of the final one is kind of when you do return to Earth and kick off all those relationships that whether they were 2 weeks or 6 months later have time has passed and you have to kind of rebuild them a little bit. But it's a very joyous experience and something that you can share with both the people on the ground and the people who are part of your crew throughout the entire mission. Great question.
All right, so I think we're going to make this the last question. We've been keeping you guys over time. So what's your name?
Alex.
This is Alex. Hold on one second.
Does being up in space allow you to see things such as the weather? Like, could you see the storm over Washington?
Well, that's a good point. Obviously, we're using a lot of satellite imagery these days, and this is going to be a major focus of some of the work NASA's doing here at home, thinking about how we can get better information about our own climate. Is that something that you guys are tracking from the space station?
Well, we have the opportunity to view a lot of the weather phenomena. We've seen many hurricanes and typhoons and whatnot around the world. We can see fronts crossing continents. We see the whole variety of cloud formations. We sometimes can see the aftermath of a storm or other major impact on the Earth after the sky clears. So there's a whole lot of details that we can see here from the space station and observe, you know, every day. We can see things. We pass over the same portion of the Earth every day, so it's a regular observation that we can make over a long period of time as well.
Well, listen, you guys have been extraordinarily generous with your time. I just want to repeat, and I think I speak for all the young people here and everybody back home, how proud we are of you, how excited we are about the work that's being done on the space station. And how committed we are to continuing human space exploration in the future. So you guys continue to be great pioneers and great role models for all of us. And we thank you for your courage. And tell your families we appreciate them letting you float up into space like this. All right? Bye-bye, guys. Nice job. Good questions.
Yeah, great questions.
I was very impressed. I can tell this is going to be a...
Endeavour, ISS, this is Houston. This concludes the event. Thank you, Mr. President. Endeavour, ISS, we are now resuming operational audio communication.
The day's activities on board the International Space Station and Endeavour will focus on transferring the regenerative life support equipment into the new Tranquility node. That equipment is separated out into various phone booth-sized racks, many of them inside the Destiny laboratory module, And now that Tranquility is there, they can be relocated to that place and free up room inside the lab for additional research facilities. Continuing to watch a view on the outside of the International Space Station and Space Shuttle Endeavour, as Endeavour's robotic arm is being maneuvered slightly to a different position for a more stable configuration for when Endeavour undocks from the station Friday evening. It also coincides with the reboost of the station's altitude tonight using Endeavour's engines. The arm still has the orbiter boom sensor system attached, and we'll leave that attached for the undocking, ready for the light inspection procedures following Endeavour's departure from the station, during which the same procedures are followed from the Flight Day 2 activities to inspect Endeavour's heat shield for any damage, this time from micrometeoroid or orbital debris during Endeavour's stay at the station. This camera is set up inside the Unity node, looking towards Destiny. Astronauts Nicholas Patrick and Bob Behnken are working in this area around the hatchway to the Quest airlock as they are reconfiguring the suits and equipment that they used for the mission's three spacewalks. They will stow equipment inside Quest that will be used for future spacewalks and also get ready and transfer equipment over to Endeavour for return to Earth. The camera view inside the Destiny Laboratory, looking forward again toward the Harmony node and the hatchway leading to the Space Shuttle Endeavour. Astronaut Steve Robinson is working on the deck or the floor of Destiny to disconnect umbilicals to the water recovery system. That system including two different phone booth sized racks that will be relocated into Tranquility. Robinson and astronaut TJ Creamer are scheduled to first relocate the water recovery system number one rack, which is the urine processor assembly component of that system. Robinson adjusting his protective equipment that he is wearing, goggles and masks and gloves, while working with these umbilicals in the water recovery system. The system uses a series of chemical processes and filters to treat astronauts' urine and perspiration and hygiene water, recycling about 93% of the fluid it receives to provide water clean enough to drink for the astronauts on board. View inside the station's Destiny Laboratory with the removal of the water recovery system rack that houses the urine processor assembly that is being moved from the Destiny lab into the new Tranquility node. This is the first rack for the relocation activities today. The air revitalization system rack has already been moved into Tranquility earlier in the mission. Station crewmates Jeff Williams and TJ Creamer and shuttle astronaut Steve Robinson are working on moving this rack, lifting it out of the deck, or basically the floor of Destiny, and moving it into Tranquility, also placing it in the deck in that node. This is a video camera set up in the Unity node looking through the hatchway towards Tranquility, where the astronauts are installing the waste and hygiene compartment into the new Tranquility node, having removed it from the U.S. Destiny laboratory.
Standby. Endeavour Houston, now for the reboost. George, we do see it underway here, and you should see some activity with your F7 lights, seeing some jet firings there. Are you not seeing that?
No, I was expecting to see something, but they're blank, and I did see them, I just now saw them firing to get into the proper attitude.
Copy, and we're watching it from down here, and our folks are telling us that, you are indeed doing the reboost, and all's well right now.
Okay, great. Now, as you were talking, I just got a right yaw activity light, and it's on the city.
Copy.
As you heard during that conversation between Capcom Mike Massimino and Shuttle Commander George Zamka, the reboost of the shuttle and space station using the Space Shuttle Reaction Control System is underway. Those engines will be firing for a total of 33 minutes to bring the shuttle and station to a 219 by 208 statute mile orbit. That again will get the space station in a good place to receive future visiting vehicles, including the Russian Soyuz vehicles and the future space shuttles as well.
Some flight deck video as we were maneuvering the OBSF to our undocked position. Well, one thing I will say about having the cupola out there is when we do look out and we can see all the components of the space station and the big arm out there, we get an appreciation for the tightness of the space and the fact that even simple moves like this require pretty strict clearance discipline to make sure that you know where the arm's going and you've got the volume in front of you clear. So, all these years we've been doing without in terms of a direct view, and then providing a direct view tells us, that was really some work that we were doing. Demonstrating our trash compaction techniques. You put it in a bag, mash it down as hard as you can, as small as you can get it, and then you gray tape it so it stays smashed up there, and then that saves volume because we don't have very much space to put our trash. We have wet trash and dry trash. I'm not sure what Bob was doing there. And here is Kay back on the robotic ops. This is actually a view from Cupola. This is the first time that we use the Cupola to observe robotic operations, which is one of its main uses. So that was pretty cool. Nick went down there and helped us watch the OBSS while it moved.
Engineering, the fluids engineering, the thermal engineering, timelines, the procedures,
a tremendous amount of human intellectual energy to get ready for this mission, and particularly today. And the folks over in the life support sides of both station and especially, especially station and also shuttle, and also the OSO folks, the mechanical system support folks, just done a tremendous amount of work behind the scenes. And we owe a huge debt of gratitude to those folks that everything actually worked.